StayAllDay.com.
Before we start, please like and comment on this video so I can get your feedback. Also, click that subscribe button so you can get all the new content I'm dropping on this channel. And the free book, the Mental Handbook, physical book, Work On Your Game University, just take care of the shipping and handling, send this right to your doorstep. Let's get started. What's going on, everybody? Dre Baldwin, DreAllDay.com. We are back, NBA 2017 season previews, team by team. Now we are talking to Indiana Pacers, who won 45 games last year. Very solid team, great performance, with given that they didn't have that much talent. I didn't think they had that much talent on that roster, but that team was very, very well coached by since fired coach. What's the guy's name who just got fired? I forget his name. He's going to come to me in 1 second. But they fired their coach. He's now in Orlando. We talked about him already in the Orlando Magic preview. Now they have Nate McMillan as a coach. I think Nate McMillan is a solid coach. He's coached the Trailblazers, and I thought he was doing pretty well with the Trailblazers. But now he's getting another opportunity in Indiana. Frank Vogel is the guy's name, the coach that they fired. So now, looking at this Indiana Pacers team, the fact that they won 45 games last year, finished the seventh seed in the Eastern Conference, were up three games to two? They were up on the Toronto Raptors and then blew that series. Didn't win. I thought they should have won because I thought Paul George was the best player on the floor in that series. They had two opportunities to close out Toronto and could not get it done. I'm going to have to put that, just talking about that, first of all, I got to put that on Paul George for two reasons. Number one, I think Paul George is the best player on the floor in the whole series. And by default, if he's the best player on the floor, he got to be the best player on his team. So Paul George should have figured out a way to get them out of that first round. That doesn't mean Paul George should have just tried to play 1-on-5 or just act like his teammates didn't exist. But if you're the best player on the floor in basketball, you got to figure out a way to make it work. And Paul George didn't get that done. So it has to be on Paul George. And I think if you ask Paul George, he would probably say it's on him because he's the best player on the team. He's the highest paid player. He's the guy everybody's looking at. They didn't get it done. It got to go on the guy who's on the top. So Paul George, we'll get to Paul George in a moment. And let's look at the roster that the Indiana Pacers have. Look at who they are bringing back, who they brought in. Aaron Brooks is on their roster now. I don't know if he was on the team last year. If he was, he should have made himself known because I didn't notice, but maybe he just got on the team this year. Aaron Brooks, a good point guard who can get in there, get some buckets, play hard defense. He won't hurt you too much being on the floor as long as he doesn't have to guard a big point guard who can abuse him in the post. Rakeem Christmas from Syracuse on their roster. Monte Ellis, a guy who we know what Monte Ellis can do. Monte Ellis is going to score you some points. Monte Ellis is going to play okay defense, not too great. And that's pretty much what you're going to get out of Monte Ellis. Monte Ellis can score. If you need some points, you need someone to get you, let's say, 14 to 16 points a night, Monte Ellis is a guy who definitely will fill that role. He will definitely get that done. Last season, he averaged 13.8 points per game, 4.7 assists, 3.3 rebounds. Yeah, he's pretty much who Monte Ellis has always been. He's been in the NBA for 11 years, came to the league straight out of high school. Guy's been around. So he was in Golden State for several years, got traded to Milwaukee, played only a season, one full season and a half a season in Milwaukee, which was actually one of his best years. His years in Golden State, he was great too. He was averaging 25 and 24 points a game in Golden State. I didn't know he scored that much in Golden State, but he was really getting his points. He was getting a lot of shots. He was shooting 20 times a game. Then he went to Milwaukee, scored about 19 a game. The last couple years before Indiana, he played in Dallas, where he averaged, again, 19 points a game, 2 years in a row. And this past year in Indiana was actually one of his lowest shot attempts. Actually, he got his fewest shot attempts per game this past season in Indiana that he's had in his whole career, except for his rookie year when he only started 3 games and played 18 minutes a game. So this past year in Indiana, he only shot the ball 12 and a half times a game, played 81 games. The guy's very durable. He's played 82, 82, 80, and 81 games the last 4 years of his career. So the guy is a reliable player. He's a guy you pretty much know what you're going to get from Monte Ellis. And a guy who's scoring 14 points a game matters on the team. Now, how he's getting that 14 matters a lot to how successful that team is going to be or how successful that team will not be. I think with the new coaching staff, Monte Ellis may be back to his old tricks, which is getting the ball a little bit more often and getting more shots, but maybe not, because there are some other players on this team who we need to talk about. Jeremy Evans, athletic wing guy, hasn't really blossomed yet. We don't know which one it is with Jeremy Evans. He's been in the league for a few years. He's 28 years old now. Let's see what he ends up doing. Paul George, we will come back to. Al Jefferson. Al Jefferson is a big pickup for the Pacers. He is a post guy who is not a huge rim protector. He's not a big presence defensively in the paint, but offensively, Al Jefferson is a hell of a presence. Al Jefferson has been, has been one of the most efficient scoring bigs in the league at certain times in his career. His last year in Charlotte, he wasn't really that because for whatever reason, the Charlotte staff felt Al Jefferson wasn't the best option for them at the center position. As far as just looking at minutes allocation, he obviously wasn't that guy. He only started 18 games last year, played 23 minutes a game, which is the fewest minutes Al Jefferson's played since 2006, when he only played 18 minutes a game in Boston. That's when he was a young guy coming out of high school, just trying to find his way in the NBA. But in Minnesota, the guys averaged 20 points a game. He went to Utah, averaged about 19 points a game 3 years straight. Then he went to Charlotte. He was averaging 22 points a game his first year in Charlotte in 35 minutes. And then his role just diminished. It went down to 16, and last year it went down to 12 points a game. So it was pretty much writing on the wall that Al Jefferson was on his way out of Charlotte. He's 31 years old, and I think he turns 32 during this season, but Al Jefferson can score his ass off in the post. If Al Jefferson is getting touches, the guy's going to get buckets. He has great post footwork. He is a great post scorer, despite the fact that he's not super athletic. So you don't have to be super athletic to be successful. Guys average 20 plus points per game in the NBA, and he's not an athletic player. He's not a guy you would say he's athletic. The guy gets it done. So Al Jefferson being in Indiana is a huge pickup for them. I think if he had been on the roster last year in the playoffs, they could have possibly beat Toronto in that first round series, because they needed someone else who could definitely get them a bucket sometimes down the stretch when they needed it. They had Paul George, but there was no one else who you could guarantee could get you a bucket. So I think that's a big pickup to have somebody like Al Jefferson who can get that done. Looking at who else is on this team, CJ Miles, a small forward who can hit that outside shot. Glenn Robinson III, another athletic wing player. Kevin Serafin, good spot duty backup big man. Julian Stone, point guard from UTEP. Maybe he'll get a chance to make this roster. Rodney Stuckey, who is a tough, solid point guard. I don't think Rodney Stuckey is a starter or even your first guard off the bench on a championship team, but he's a guy who can get in there. He's not going to hurt you as long as you don't have to play him too many minutes. Rodney Stuckey. Jeff Teague, another huge pickup coming from Atlanta. Jeff Teague has been a borderline all-star. I don't think he's made all-star, but he's been a borderline all-star. He's an athletic guy who can hang with pretty much any point guard on an athletic basis. Just physical attributes basis, Jeff Teague can go with anybody. Now, if Jeff Teague is going to actually produce at that level, who knows? And there are a lot of point guards on his roster here in Indiana, so we'll see how everything shakes out. But I think Jeff Teague is definitely your opening night starting point guard. 28 years old, is hitting his prime pretty much. So let's see what Jeff Teague does in his hometown, playing at home now in Indiana. Miles Turner, super athletic forward, who I didn't know anything about Miles Turner, but he definitely made his presence known over this past season. Thaddeus Young, pickup who was in Philadelphia, was in Brooklyn. I think Thaddeus Young is a solid player. Again, I don't see him as a starter on the championship team, but he can be eighth man on the championship team. I think he'll be a little higher on the rotation on this team. I don't think the Pacers are a championship team, but they got a solid squad here. They replaced the guys that they lost, George Hill. They replaced, who else did they lose? Actually, I don't think they lost anyone else who was that important to their George Hill. I think he was the biggest. Frank Vogel was the other biggest, and they replaced him. Jeff Teague, who, how does he compare to George Hill? I think George Hill is a little bit better than Jeff Teague, but Jeff Teague is better in certain ways that does certain things that George Hill does not do. He just has the athleticism, I think, and a little bit more scoring punch than George Hill has. But at the same time, they also added Al Jefferson. Al Jefferson, who can get down there in that paint and get those buckets. But now let's talk about the superstar on this team. Let's talk about Mr. Paul George. Paul George is only 26 years old. He's 6'9". He missed an entire season the year before when he broke his leg playing with Team USA. Came back last year, had a great year. He averaged 23 points a game, 4 assists and 7 rebounds, a 21 PER. The guy is a superstar. We can all agree that Paul George is a superstar. He played, since he's been in the league, he played all 66 games of the lockout season. He played only 19 games. He's played 61 games, but he started only 19 as a rookie. But after that, his second year in the league, all 66 games. Next year, 79, then 80 games. Then he played in six games. He played in six games in 2014, 2015, I think at the end of the year when he was coming back from his leg injury. And last year he played in 81 games, 35 minutes a game, 42% from the floor, which is not great. He shot seven threes a night, hit 37%. I think his percentages can come up a little bit on those three-point shots. I think he'll get to the foul line a little bit more. He shot only 6.5 last year. Rebounding, 7 rebounds, I told you, 4 assists. 2 steals per game, 23 points. I think Paul George could get that number up. I think he could get it up to the 24-25 range. However, he is going to be giving up some shots to a guy like Jeff Teague, who's more of a lead guard than a point guard, and a guy like Al Jefferson, who needs to get some touches if he's going to be effective, if you're going to have him on the floor. Paul George can be the best player on a team that can go at least to the second round of the playoffs, which has already been proven, right? They've proven that. They even went to the Eastern Conference Finals. So I think he's already definitely proven he can be the best player on the team that goes to a conference finals. I don't know what happened last year, why he didn't help them close out that Toronto Raptors team. I think they should have closed out the Raptors last year. But last year is over, is a new year. What do I think the Indiana Pacers can do coming into this season? This roster is actually a pretty good roster. It really depends on how Coach Nate McMillan makes all of this work. If he can make it all work together the right way, making sure that everything centers around Paul George, making sure that Monte Ellis and Jeff Teague don't take too many shots away from Paul George and Al Jefferson, who are the two guys who should be getting the ball the most. And then defensively, they're going to have to figure out what they're doing. And this roster needs to be pared down. There's a lot of names on this. I'm making this in mid-September, so obviously everybody's not going to be on the team opening night. I think the Pacers can, since last year, let me see what they did last year. I know that they were the 7th seed in the Eastern Conference, but I want to see how close they were to being anything higher than the 7th seed. They won 45 games. The 6th seed, who was the Charlotte Hornets, won 48 games. Boston won 48, and the Hawks won 48, and the Heat won 48. So the Pacers were 3 games away from being a top 3 seed in the Eastern Conference. They can win 48 games. They can win 48, 49 games this year and get to that number 3 seed in the East, which could get them, is going to get them home court advantage, could get them to the second round. But it was a huge log jam there from the 3rd seed, Heat. 4th was Atlanta. 5th was Boston. 6th was Charlotte. 7th was Indiana. And then Indiana was only 1 game up on the Detroit Pistons, who finished as the 8th seed. So that number 3 through 8 seeds in the Eastern Conference, those teams were all log jammed together. So the Pacers could, just like all the rest of the teams that I'm going to be mentioning in this group, well, except one of them, I think, they could all end up in that top 3. They could end up in the 3rd seed in the East. I think the top 2 seeds, Toronto and Cleveland, I think they're going to stay the top 2 seeds. I'm giving that away before I get to those teams, but I think they'll be top 2. I think the Pacers can be number 3. I also think Detroit, if they mature, those players mature, they got a great coach that can help them do that, they can also get into that top 3 seed, but we'll see. As far as the pace, but I think the Pacers will finish higher than Detroit just because they got Paul George. And I think because they have Al Jefferson, who I know what he can do. Can he still do it? We got to find out, because I know he's had some injuries. Overall, I'm going to put the Pacers in the number 3 seed. I think they can get the number 3 seed in the Eastern Conference, the Indiana Pacers. Go in there, win in the first round, get to that second round series where they'd be looking at maybe playing Toronto again, which would be great. I think they can beat Toronto. I think the Pacers can get to the Eastern Conference Finals and play against the Cleveland Cavaliers. So we get to see Paul George against LeBron James again. Didn't think we'd get it to happen this way, but I think that can definitely happen this upcoming season. Pacers fans, Pacers haters, NBA fans, NBA haters, what do you think? Questions, comments, concerns, praise, criticisms. Leave it down here in the comments. Y'all know what to do with that on YouTube. The next video, we will be talking about another Eastern Conference team. I think we got 5 Eastern Conference teams in a row. Next one will be the Charlotte Hornets. They made some changes. Let's see what they're going to do next year. Everybody, work on your game. DreAllDay.com.